Anyway, welcome everyone, and so happy that you can be here and join us today on this third Sunday after Pentecost. And also, I notice we have a few visitors here, so we welcome you as well. And normally we would say something like, hope we get to meet and greet you at the end of the service, but under this COVID-19, we'll just have to do air hugs or elbow bumps, right? I think that's what it is. But we're happy that you're here and to be a part of our service today. Now, we're going to be focusing on our gospel lesson today. It comes from Matthew's gospel, and he tells us about his very own call to follow Jesus, even though he had been a tax collector for the Romans. And as a result of that, he was actually a Jewish outcast, okay? He was an outcast of their society. But it's wonderful that the Lord called him, and we rejoice to hear with Matthew that Jesus had come to call not the righteous people, but tax collectors and sinners. And that's great, because we fall into that very category, don't we, of being sinners. So we know that we qualify as being the right people for Jesus to call. We're going to talk more about that later, but maybe you've already seen in the bulletin that our theme for today is Jesus' call to you. That's what we'll explore further in our lesson today, our sermon. We're using an abbreviated version, so we're trying some different things. So an abbreviated version of our order of service, right, number two, you'll find that on page 60. And then just as a quick reminder to everyone, we are having a communion. If you haven't been here for our communion service before, I'll be bringing the communion to you. So you'll just stay in your pews as you're singing the distribution hymns, and I will bring it to you. So, all right. So now I think I made all the announcements that I need to make. So let us begin by singing our opening hymn, hymn 423. Thank you. And so we turn now to page 60 as we continue with the invocation. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins to God our Father, beseeching Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said I will confess my transgressions to the Lord. Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess unto you that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against you by thought, word, and deed. Therefore we flee for refuge to your infinite mercy, seeking and imploring your grace for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. O most merciful God,
you have given your only begotten Son to die for us. Have mercy on us, and for your sake, grant us remission of all our sins, and by your Holy Spirit, increase in us true knowledge of you, and of your will, and true obedience to your word, to the end that by your grace we may come to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, has had mercy upon us, and has given his only begotten Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. To all who believe on his name, he gives power to become the children of God, and has promised them his Holy Spirit. He who believes and is baptized shall be saved.
Grant this unto us, O Lord. Amen.
We join together in singing the Gloria Patri, page 62.
Thank you.
God, the strength of all who trust in you, mercifully hear our prayers. Be gracious to us in our weakness, and give us strength to keep your commandments in all we say and do. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. We now turn to the written word, which is printed on the back of your bulletin. And our Old Testament lesson for this Sunday is taken from the book of Hosea, chapter 5, beginning with verse 15. Then I will return to my lair until they have borne their guilt and seek my face. In their misery, they will earnestly seek me. Come, let us return to the Lord. He has torn us to pieces, but he will heal us. He has injured us, but he will bind up our wounds. After 2 days, he will revive us. On the third day, he will restore us, that we may live in his presence. Let us acknowledge the Lord. Let us press on to acknowledge him. As surely as the sun rises, he will appear. He will come to us like the winter rains, like the spring rains that water the earth. What can I do with you, Ephraim? What can I do with you, Judah? Your love is like the morning mist, like the early dew that disappears. Therefore I cut you in pieces with my prophets. I killed you with the words of my mouth. Then my judgments go forth like the sun. For I desire mercy, not sacrifice, and acknowledgement of God rather than burnt offerings. This is the word of our Lord. Our epistle lesson comes to us from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 4, beginning with verse 18. And Paul writes, "Against all hope, Abraham, in hope, believed, and so became the father of many nations, just as it had been said to him, so shall your offspring be. Without weakening in his faith, he faced the fact that his body was as good as dead, since he was about 100 years old, and that Sarah's womb was also dead. Yet he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God, but was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God, being fully persuaded that God had power to do what he had promised. This is why it was credited to him as righteousness. The words it was credited to him were written not for him alone, but also for us, to whom God will credit righteousness, for us who believe in him, who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead. He was delivered over to death for our sins and was raised to life for our justification. This is the word of our Lord." Our gospel lesson is taken from Matthew's gospel. As I mentioned, that will be the text for our sermon today, and so it will be read at that time. So let us now confess our Christian faith together as expressed in the words of the Nicene Creed. You'll find it on page 69. "I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being in one substance with the Father, by him all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate Well, grace, peace, and mercy be to all of you in the name of God, our Heavenly Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. So our sermon text, as I've mentioned, is coming from our gospel lesson, the Gospel of Matthew chapter 9, as we're going to focus then on those verses 9 through 13, and that also is printed on the back of your bulletin. You're certainly welcome to follow along as I invite you to rise for this gospel reading. So Matthew records for us, "As Jesus went on from there, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at the tax collector's booth. 'Follow me,' he told him, and Matthew got up and followed him. While Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house, many tax collectors and sinners came and ate with him and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, 'Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?' On hearing this, Jesus said, 'It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. But go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice, for I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners.'" Thus our text, and we pray. Lord Jesus, how grateful we are that your mission was to save sinners like ourselves. Help us and empower us with your word to heed your call to follow you in all that we say and do, and to tell others about you and your gracious forgiveness. In your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Well, dear fellow believers, 35 years ago last month, I still remember attending the special call service on the campus of Concordia Theological Seminary there in Fort Wayne, Indiana. That was the night that all of the graduates received their assignments, received their call, and we were all just anticipating very nervously about that. And when it got to that point in the service where the assignments or the call was being stated, the person would state your name, then state the congregation, then the city and the state. Now, the dean of students, at this particular one anyway, it's the only one I've ever attended, actually, but he had a little fun and with a couple of the graduates. And so he announced their name and then the congregation, and then he said, "In Brazil, Indiana." And then there was another one I remember who, and again, his name, congregation, Paris, Texas. So our eyes got a little wide there a couple of times, but, and there was some laugh with both calls. But then came the name, Rodney Allen Floor, Gloria Day Lutheran Church, Cold Spring, Minnesota. And that call had my wife and I moving from the Hoosier state of Indiana to the land of 10,000 lakes. And for 14 years, I had the wonderful privilege of serving here. And then following a couple of other calls elsewhere, I had the wonderful opportunity to come back. My father-in-law said that I was recalled. But I was thrilled to serve you once again. I was thinking about all of this as I was preparing for the sermon today. And the reason, of course, is due to the fact that our gospel lesson focuses our attention on Jesus' call to Matthew to serve him in public ministry. Now, I suspect that none of this really grabs your attention as being riveting or on the edge of your seats, neither my recollection of my call service, and maybe even not Matthew's call to serve as a full-time disciple. I mean, what does that have to do with you anyway? What does that have to do with you personally today? Well, my goal this morning is to answer that question by connecting the dots between this portion of Scripture and your personal life. So with that goal in mind, let's take a few moments to study the text under the theme that you see there in your bulletin, Jesus' call to you. Now there are two things that we want to note about Jesus and his call to you. First, we want to see that Jesus' call to you had the power to change your life. And secondly, Jesus' call to you has the power to change the lives of people around you. Now, in order for us to truly grasp the powerful impact of the Lord's call to Matthew, we want to just step back for a moment and remember what it was that Matthew did for a living. Matthew's job was that of being a tax collector. And as a tax collector, Matthew then assessed taxes on his fellow countrymen, the Jews, and he did that on behalf of the hated Romans who were ruling over the nation of Israel at that time. Matthew, however, did not get paid by the Romans directly. He didn't receive a salary. So how did Matthew get his income? Well, Matthew's pay consisted of whatever he chose to charge his countrymen over and above what he was required to give to the Romans. See, there was no general accounting office to oversee how much Matthew was actually charging. There was no nightly news program like the old 60 Minutes that blew the whistle on Matthew becoming so rich at other people's expenses. There was no 1-800-CALL-CAESAR hotline to complain that Matthew is charging us way too much in taxes. And as a result, together with all his fellow tax collectors, because they were all doing it, Matthew was despised by his fellow Jews. In fact, as soon as Matthew became a tax collector, he was excommunicated from the synagogue. He was forbidden to serve as a witness in any Jewish court, and he was ostracized by his fellow Jews. And so while Matthew's life may have been outwardly flowing with material wealth, on a personal level, Matthew's life was a barren desert. But all of that changed, however, when one day Matthew was sitting in his tax collector's booth doing his job, when suddenly Jesus of Nazareth shows up and he says to him, "Follow me." Now, this probably was not the first time that Matthew had at least some contact with Jesus and the message that he was proclaiming. Our text for today tells us that it took place in Capernaum, I should say, the Galilean headquarters, if you will, of Jesus in his outreach ministry. And Luke's gospel tells us that news about Jesus had spread far and wide throughout the entire region. So the whole area was abuzz about this man from Nazareth. Jesus, the Bible also tells us, had miraculously healed many people right there in Capernaum. And in fact, Jesus had just healed the paralytic who had been brought to him on a mat. Remember that story? So what I'm saying with all of that is that it's very likely that Matthew had at least heard about this Jesus, what he was doing and what he was preaching. But it's even more possible that Matthew may have personally seen and heard Jesus directly. Either way, the Holy Spirit had been working in Matthew's heart. So much so that when Jesus came up to Matthew, the tax collector, sitting there doing his job in his booth, and said to him, "Follow me," Matthew immediately got up, left behind everything, and followed Jesus. So how did Matthew's life change? Well, just think about this for a moment. Matthew lost his job, but he gained his calling.
Matthew lost a great source of earthly wealth, but he received an infinitely greater heavenly inheritance. Matthew had lost a relatively safe and secure life on this earth, but now he knew his Savior, a Savior who gave him a guaranteed safe and secure eternal life. Yes, my friends, Jesus' call to Matthew most certainly had the power to change Matthew's life forever. At the same time, Jesus' call to Matthew had the power to change the lives of others as well, did it not? Because what did Matthew do right after Jesus had called him to be a disciple? We see it right there in our text, verse 10, where it tells us while Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house, many tax collectors and sinners came and ate with him and his disciples. See, Matthew knew what it was like to be an outcast among his own people. But now Matthew also knew what it was like to experience the grace and mercy, the love and the forgiveness of the Lord his God. And so Matthew not only invites Jesus and his disciples to come have dinner with him at his house, but he also invites fellow outcasts, those hated tax collectors and other well-known sinners, so that they too could come into contact and meet Jesus. You and I can only imagine what was discussed by Jesus while they were eating together with those tax collectors and sinners. But it's a pretty safe bet that they weren't talking about gas prices and the weather. No, without a doubt, Jesus used God's holy law to call these sinners to repent of their sins and to leave their life of sin behind them. Without a doubt, Jesus proclaimed the glorious message of the gospel so that these repentant sinners would be assured of God's forgiveness. And without a doubt, these tax collectors and sinners remember this dinner date for the rest of their lives. And, at least for me anyway, it's very easy to envision that Jesus' call to Matthew changed the lives of at least some of these invited guests, maybe all of them, for all eternity. It changed their lives by bringing these tax collectors and sinners into a personal contact with their Savior. So, when did Jesus come to you and say, "Follow me"? Well, for most of you, that happened on the day of your baptism, because it was on that day that you were called to faith. And on that very day, both you and your life changed. You were changed from being a child of Satan to being a child of God. You were changed from being lost in the darkness of sin to walking in the light of saving faith. And you were changed from living only for yourself and for the temporary things that this world has to offer to living for the Lord and for what he has in store for you in his heaven. On that day, when you were baptized, the gift of saving faith was created in your heart. And that precious gift did indeed change your life as well as your eternity. So next comes a very important and very personal question. Is that change as open and as obvious in your life as it was in the life of Matthew? When you're at work or out with friends, are people able to see and hear that you are a saved child of God? Now, I don't mean that you're, thumping people, everyone that you meet, over the head with a Bible. Maybe asking them, have you been washed in the blood of the Lamb? I'm not saying that. Rather, can people see and hear of your Christian faith in the words that you speak and the kind of lives that you lead? When you're at home, is your family able to tell that you trust in Christ as your only Savior from sin? That He is an important part of who you are and not just something that you put on like an overcoat on Sunday mornings? Now, if perhaps that change in your life is not as evident as it should be, it's not too late. No matter what your age, no matter what your station in life, no matter what your circumstances are, it's not too late to turn that around. So let me encourage all of you here to take a knee in spirit at the foot of the cross and ask your Savior to grant you complete forgiveness along with renewed strength and dedication to Him. Because I want you also to remember and to encourage all of you that Jesus' call to you is not only a call to saving faith, but Jesus' call to you is a call to service. Now, I'm pretty sure that none of you have a call document like I received from you, the congregation. But each of you has most assuredly been called by Christ Himself. It's true. You, me, we all have been called to be a servant of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, a minister and a proclaimer of the gospel in His kingdom here on this earth. And first and foremost, this means that that you are to follow the example that Matthew gives to you here in our text and to do whatever you can to bring others into contact with Jesus. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, talk about your faith to your friends, your relatives, your acquaintances, your neighbors. And again, I'm not talking about getting into debates about religion, or worse yet, getting into arguments, because that's never helpful, and it's almost always hurtful. No, I'm talking about letting your Christian faith shine, that it's self-evident in what you say and what you do. Be bold. Invite them to church. Ask them to join you in Bible class. Use your time, your talents, and yes, your treasures to support the Lord's kingdom work here in our congregation, as well as across the whole world through the outreach efforts of our synod. And especially, dear people, given the turmoil that has just erupted and exploded throughout our country, remember to treat people around you the way your Savior God treats you, so that perhaps they too will come to know the grace and the mercy, the love and the forgiveness that can only be found at the foot of the cross of Christ. Jesus' call to you, my friends, may not have come to you in exactly the same way that it came to Matthew here in our text, or His call to you may not include serving in the public ministry of His church. Still, His call to each and every one of you is both powerful and real. Jesus' call to you is indeed a call to service, as you now strive to bring people around you in contact with their Savior. And so may God grant that in light of Jesus' call to all of us, that we all strive to live a life worthy of the call that each and every one of us has received. To God be the glory. Amen. Please rise for the blessing. And now may the peace of God, which transcends all human understanding, keep your hearts and your minds firmly planted in the risen Christ. Amen. You may be seated. As I think most of you know, we're not having ushers during this COVID-19 thing that's going on. So there won't be an offering collected, but you probably saw when you came in, there's an offering plate in the back at the Lord, so guide you to do that. But I still want to announce our worship participation cards that even as members, I mean, if you're visiting, we'd love to have your name, address, any way that we can make contact with you about our ministry here. But even if you're members, if you have an address change, email, phone number, any kind of change like that, you can put that on the card or even a prayer request, which we've had in the past too. And then you can, at the end of the service, put that card in the offering plate. So let us pray. Dear Father, though you are exalted over heaven and earth, nevertheless you have mercy and compassion upon the lowly. And so we come to you confidently with all of our needs, trusting that you will supply them. And so we do come to you, Lord, for food and clothing and shelter, good health and steady employment, protection and all other things that we require. And because we still have our sinful flesh, we confess that we are in danger of desiring more than what is sufficient and striving for things that are not good for us. And so we leave the final selection of all of our earthly blessings to your wisdom and your holy will. We do ask that you would especially watch over the elderly among us, the widows, the widowers, the fatherless, the injured and infirm, the disabled, the poor, the downcast, and the oppressed. Supply them according to their several needs. And forgive our sins, especially all those times we, your children, complained about our lot in life and forgot about your many blessings. Forgive all the times that we were dissatisfied and wanted more than what was sufficient for us. Forgive all those times that we did not share our abundance with those in need. Forgive all those times we neglected to thank and praise your holy name. Forgive us for Jesus' sake. And lead our entire nation to repentance, that it may escape your wrath and displeasure. Heavenly Father, we are but strangers and pilgrims on this earth, but you have promised us everlasting life in heaven through your dear Son. And so through the Holy Spirit, feed our souls on Christ, who is the true bread of life. And dear Father, we thank you for the gift of fatherhood. And we pray especially on this National Father's Day that you would grant people everywhere the blessing of a loving father at home. But in homes where fathers have neglected their duties or have been absent, help the children and the family to persevere and to set their ideal for parenthood in your word. We thank you for our fathers and ask your blessings upon each of them. Direct us to honor, love, and respect them every day and in every way. And bless our families in the true faith in Jesus, so that we may spend eternity together in your heaven. We also want to lift up to you your servants Arnis and Arnie Thielen as they celebrate 60 years together as man and wife. As companions on the journey through life, they have loved, consoled, and supported each other. But most important, they have grown closer to you. By your grace, they have maintained a Christian home and raised their children in the training and instruction of the Lord.
They have learned forgiveness and unconditional love from you. Your word has been a lamp to their feet and a light in their path. Keep them committed to each other and to you. Continue to supply their earthly needs according to your will, and give them happiness and joy in the years to come. We also lift up to you your servant Joe Howe, as he is being deployed to Mogadishu. We ask for your protection over him in every situation, and bless him as he serves our country through our armed forces. Guard his faith in Christ, and permit no temptation to harm him in any way, but strengthen him for the experiences that he must face. Protect his body and his health, and let nothing harmful happen to him as he carries out the work assigned to him in the service of our country. And especially if his duties call him into areas of great danger, be with him, dear Lord, and protect him from all evil. Please help him as you have promised, so that he may praise and glorify your saving name forever, through his Savior and Lord, Jesus Christ. We also pray for all of our policemen and firemen and those who are serving our community, that you would provide protection for them too, and keep them safe as they seek to uphold law and order and to serve our country. We lift up to you as well your servant Maynard Pitt, who has been hospitalized for some serious heart issues. Bless the care he is receiving and use it to bring about a restoration of health so that he can return home very soon. And bless Sandy and keep her and her family in your gracious care. And merciful God and Father, you are the Lord of all creation. And we do thank you for the recent rains that we received this past week, but we are in need of much more. We implore you to remember our need for more rain to revive refresh the earth. We pray that you'll not let our crops and plants wither and die for lack of moisture, but we pray that you would open the heavens and send gentle, plentiful rains. These conditions that threaten us do make us realize that we can plant and cultivate, that you alone can bring growth and produce a bountiful harvest. Graciously hear our prayer. And finally, gracious Father, make the gospel of Christ the joy of our hearts, and through it increase our faith and strengthen our hold on eternal life. Father, we know that you have forgiven all our sins and supplied all of our needs. Therefore, to you, we raise our voices in praise and prayer as we pray together the prayer you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We join together now in singing the Sanctus on page 76 of your hymn. Lord Jesus Christ, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way also he took the cup after supper, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new testament in my blood, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. Receive now the Lord's Supper. Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant to you his peace. By way of announcements, there's not a lot of them there. Although there is, you maybe notice there's an announcement about telling your relatives and friends. We certainly want to encourage you to do that. Merle has been taping, I guess that's what you call it, you know, a little tape, right? But recording our service this morning, he did last week as well. Yeah, I don't know if any of you have seen our worship services via our website or on YouTube, but we're doing it slightly different now. Before it was just me, and the camera was right here. So you got that close up, okay? I waited for Hollywood to call, they never did. No, there's other reasons. So the council wanted to see whether or not how well this would work, or we actually take the service itself with our congregation. So, if any of you have thoughts on that, or anybody that's maybe watching this at home, give us some feedback as to whether or not this works for you, because ultimately our goal is that we want to serve you in the best way that we can. The only drawback of this, as we've mentioned before at the meetings, is that it won't be available, obviously, Sunday morning. It'll probably be available sometime tomorrow as we get it then uploaded to our website and to YouTube. As far as other announcements, the ladies' group is not going to be meeting May 22nd or June 22nd, right? Neither one of those days. Not going to be meeting. But anyway, we'll be meeting one of these days soon when we can finally get back to some sort of normalcy and have our worship services as well as our other activities. Because there's a garage sale that's going to be coming up sometime in the future. Are there any other announcements that need to be made, Linda, or anyone else? Okay. Happy Father's Day again to everybody. Happy anniversary. I believe those flowers on the piano are in honor of 60 years together. What do you think, Arnie? Is it going to work? Or? Jerry is still out on that. Okay, very good. Well, we're hoping for 60 more. Yeah, today I know. God bless you. Wonderful. Praise the Lord. And, thank the Lord and blessings to you too, Arliss. You know, for the...
A lot of kids.
Yeah. Took a lot of patience, I'm sure. Yeah, on many levels. Used to have a member of one of my other churches that said if you had any more patients, you'd be a doctor. I don't think he got it. Anyway. But we're happy that all of you could be with us here today. Again, welcome to those of you who are visiting. Be sure to greet one another with, as I said, the air hugs or elbows or whatever way, but just say hi to one another. And may God bless your daily walk. And I'll, as I have been doing, I'll usher you out, okay? Get the equipment on here. Have a great week, and I hope that one day soon we'll be able to get together again and also for our fellowship, too. We certainly miss that time after church. But God bless you. Have a wonderful day.